In 1841, the discovery of many bones around England that belonged to ancient reptiles caused Richard Owen to coin the phrase dinosaur. In 1859, The Origin of Species was published, and the idea of deep time shaping the Earth had been played with for some time before either of these. However, it wasn't until the early 20th century that a functioning method for dating the fossils and the Earth was actually discovered. The methods used before this were wildly inaccurate and inconsistent, with estimates for the Earth's age ranging anywhere from 50,000 years to 300 million years. So despite a big scientific interest in the concept of deep time, during the Victorian period, no one really had any idea how old these things in the ground were, until the discovery of radiometric dating. One thing the early naturalists did get right was that it was well known that rock layers predictably formed in order, which is known as stratigraphy. Stratigraphy is still used today as it has a wide set of applications when used alongside radiometric and other forms of dating. However, at the time of its discovery, not much was known about how the different rock layers or stratas formed, but since the Victorian period it was well understood that they were chronological, and they even fueled some theories about how evolution worked that were later proved wrong by natural selection. For instance, some believed that the end of each strata and the beginning of another was the exact moment where all the animals changed instantly. However, even as the understanding of how animals actually evolve and adapt to their environments improved, the problem was that they had no way of telling how old anything was. Stratigraphy could only be used relatively. They knew which rock layers or creatures were older or younger compared with each other, but not exactly how old they were. In the early 1900s, it was discovered that radioactive elements decay into new elements over time at a predictable rate, and it didn't take long for people to realise that this could be used as a way to date the Earth. A chemist named Bertram Boltwood concluded that since there was always some amount of lead present in uranium, that this must be the endpoint of its radioactive decay. After studying this and working out that the speed uranium decays is very predictable, he reasoned that it could be used to measure the age of the element. His results showed the age of the Earth at 2.2 billion years old, still way off, but considerably older and closer than almost all predictions before this. But more importantly, this is still the basic principle behind radiometric dating that is used today. However, knowledge of atomic structure and advancements in technology have made uranium dating accurate to about 2 million years, and so is now an effective tool to date the Earth. When thinking of radiometric dating, carbon dating usually comes to mind. However, this was not the first radiometric dating method discovered. But also, carbon dating is not actually used very much with prehistory, or used at all for dating very ancient things like rock formations or fossils. Carbon-14 slowly decays into nitrogen, and it takes about 5,700 years for the carbon to decay by half, which is its half-life. Current machinery and techniques that measure carbon-14 are sensitive enough to accurately measure the age of something up to around 60,000 years. Which means that fossils and dinosaurs, let alone very ancient earthy structures, are far too old to be dated using carbon dating. However, the half-life of certain isotopes of uranium is 4.5 billion years, meaning that certain uranium elements present since the Earth formed have only just decayed by half. So the most common elements used for dating in paleontology are elements like uranium and potassium that have very long half-lives. However, there are advantages to carbon dating that still make it worthwhile to the field. Carbon-14 is created in the atmosphere, which is exchanged into plants, which are eaten by herbivorous animals, which are then eaten by omnivorous and carnivorous creatures. This means carbon-14 is always finding its way into the food chain, keeping a fixed level of carbon in living creatures. At the point the creature dies, this is no longer happening, so the carbon isn't being replenished. This means that carbon dating is actually measuring from the point the creature died. This makes it very useful for measuring when Ice Age creatures that have their bodies preserved in permafrost, like mammoths, because within the accuracy range that carbon dating allows, it is actually measuring when these creatures met their end. However, there are also limitations to carbon dating. Since carbon-14 is created in the atmosphere, it only works on plants and animals that have exchanged almost all of their carbon with the air. Water blocks UV rays from the sun, which means that carbon-14 in marine environments can already be depleted. But also, some creatures exchange carbon with other sources, not just the air, which gives them exposure to very old carbon. For instance, snails consume limestone and use the carbon to build their shells. So carbon dating snails produces wildly inaccurate results. However, it isn't just confined to animals that consume old carbon, as it can also find its way up the food chain through animals like snails being eaten by predators. For habitats on dry land, this usually doesn't cause much of an issue because there aren't enough animals like this in the ecosystem. However, consuming limestone is something shared by all shelled mollusks, including cephalopods like cuttlefish. Because these animals are more common in marine environments, marine animals in general have much more exposure to old carbon, making it very difficult to carbon date even marine predators. So carbon dating is very useful because you can quite reliably tell that the decay of the carbon started when the living thing you are trying to date died. However, this is not the case with fossils. The fossilization process does not necessarily restart the element's decay upon its formation, meaning that it may contain elements that are older than the fossil. In addition to this, fossils are usually formed from materials that do not lend themselves well to radiometric dating. Because of this, fossils are actually rarely dated directly, and in fact, scientists actually date the rock layer or strata that the fossils are hosted in. Fossils are usually found in sedimentary rock like limestone, sandstone, and shale, which are also quite difficult to date directly. One way this can be done is using a technique known as magnetostratigraphy. The iron contents of rocks magnetize in the direction of the magnetic field at the time of the formation of the rock layer. By using the record of the Earth's magnetic field throughout the Earth's history, allows them to be dated. Sedimentary rocks nearly always have some amount of iron contents, and so can often be dated this way. However, many ancient sediments are unsuitable to be dated like this. Although these types of sedimentary layers can't be radiometrically dated directly, there are still methods for uncovering their age using radiometric dating. For instance, you can date other objects that are hosted in the ancient sediments. Zircon crystals are incredibly hardy and are routinely able to survive in sedimentary rocks. They are quite common in sandstone in particular and contain trace amounts of uranium that can be dated. If there are many zircons contained within a layer of sediment, the youngest crystals will represent the oldest age that that sediment can be. An added bonus of zircons are they strongly reject lead, the endpoint of uranium-238. This means that all lead must be the result of decay and can't be from contamination. The date of a particular rock layer can also be dated via having a really good understanding of the rocks near it. If there is a rock layer that does not possess any very datable materials, you may still be able to work out a maximum minimum age that the fossils contained in that rock layer could be if you know the date of the rock layer just above or just below it. This happens a lot with volcanic eruptions that can be easily identified in or between rock strata. Volcanic ash reliably contains potassium that can be radiometrically dated, and volcanic eruptions happen within a small time frame, offering a good reference point for dating other objects that might be near them in the rocks. So because some rocks are difficult to date radiometrically, stratigraphy is still a powerful tool for dating the Earth when coupled with certain reference points that have been well studied. So sometimes the fact we know the age of the Earth as well as the age of many events throughout prehistory can be taken for granted, and this can give the wrong impression. It wasn't until the early 20th century that people really had any clue at all how old anything was, and aging the Earth is a complicated and multifaceted field that is still advancing to this day. Thank you for watching. A big thank you goes to all my patrons, especially the big contributors that are listed here. If you like content like this, then consider becoming a patron as well.